Secretary Malinowski.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Rubio, Senator Boxer, Senator Kaine. It's a pleasure to be here. I will say a few words about our global programs to support people who are struggling for advances in democracy and human rights around the world. And I'll start by acknowledging that this is obviously not an easy time to be doing this kind of work. It is a time, as we can all see from the headlines, when authoritarian governments, beginning with big powers like Russia and China, are striking out with great ferocity against freedoms of expression, association, and the press. There is the horrible war in Syria and the terror of ISIL and the mass migrations of refugees and the fear that all of this insecurity creates, even in democratic countries, with all of the impact on our politics that we have seen. Now, all of that should disturb us. I don't think it should surprise us. After all, freedom has advanced in waves over the last few decades. It has been followed by the advances in the internet and the global civil society, which have allowed people in just about every closed society in the world to know exactly what they are missing and to connect with each other and with people around the world to build effective movements for social change. People often say to me that human rights is a soft issue. I think it is the hardest hard power issue there is, because its advance is a threat to some of the most dangerous people in the world. If you're trying to steal an election or to stay in office for life or to profit from corruption, then of course you are going to be threatened by NGOs and by journalists who try to expose those abuses of power. Of course you are going to fight back, and you're going to fight hard, and you're going to fight dirty, and that's what we are facing in many parts of the world. But as I look around the world, I find that the good guys are still winning as many victories as they're losing, particularly when we're there to help them. Just in the last year, look at the historic elections that took place in Burma, in Nigeria, in Sri Lanka, even in Venezuela, where the people haven't won, but they were able to manifest their enormous desire for change through an election. So the lesson I take from that is that if we have patience and determination, if we stick with these efforts and with these programs, we are going to win more victories than the defeats that we face. And that's where the funding that you provide my bureau, DRL, through our Human Rights and Democracy Fund comes in. It's not a lot of money. It's about $85 million this year. We like to think of it as our venture capital fund for freedom. We're using it to get news, knowledge, and even entertainment into North Korea, an effort that we know is changing minds and awakening expectations in the most closed society on Earth. We're using it to support the legal defense of activists and dissidents in multiple countries where they're being persecuted. We're using it to support former political prisoners in Burma so that they can contribute to building democracy there and to fight the religious hatred that threatens their democracy. We're using it to develop and deploy cutting-edge technologies that break through China's Great Firewall and to protect activists in dozens of countries from cyber attacks and cyber intrusions. We're using it to help organizations defending freedom of expression in Latin America. One of our programs recently supported a campaign that saved Ecuador's number one press freedom watchdog. We're using it to keep civil society organizations alive in Syria, where groups we funded have negotiated ceasefires, documented the crimes of the Assad regime, and organized communities to stand up to ISIL and al-Nusra. We're using it to prevent atrocities, for example, setting up early warning systems in remote areas of the Eastern Congo so that people there can call for help when they're threatened by armed groups, and in Nigeria to protect people from Boko Haram. We're using it to help women who have escaped ISIL captivity in northern Iraq. We're using it to support organizations that try to build trust between Muslim communities and the police in eastern Kenya so that they can unite against al-Shabaab. We're using it to get help to people who need it faster than I think any other agency in the U.S. government. Our emergency grant programs can get small but sometimes life-saving amounts of money to activists and NGOs under threat in as little as 48 hours. We're using these programs right now to provide protection and assistance to some of the bloggers and others who have been threatened in Bangladesh, one of many examples. And to save the best for last, from a fiscal standpoint at least, let me say that we also use it to support the work of NGOs and journalists that expose corruption around the world. This work has contributed to almost $3 billion in confiscations and fines, including over $1 billion in Justice Department seizures, which is a pretty good investment for your DRL funds, I would say. So I want to thank you for the very strong support that this committee and the Congress has shown our programs over the years, and I pledge to you that with continued support, we will continue to do work that I think not only does our country proud, but that makes us safer, more secure, stronger in the long run. Thank you very much.